How long then did Paul and Barnabas spend teaching in Antioch? Chapter 11, verse 26 says, a whole year, not just most of the year, like 9 or 10 months, a whole year, 12 months. And if you were to look at other passages in the book of Acts, you would see that Paul spent a year and a half in Corinth, chapter 18, verse 11, and 2 years in Ephesus, chapter 19, verse 10. From this, we gain the general point, useful for us to know, that Paul's teaching was strategic. He targeted cities, key cities, from whence the faith would then spread. So he spent 2 years in Ephesus, which was the center for reaching Asia Minor or Western Turkey. 2 years, he thought. Got the church grounded, then this church can engage in evangelizing the surrounding area. He spent 18 months in Corinth, an important harbor city in what we call Greece. Harbor cities, important for spreading the faith too. He spent 1 year in Antioch. It's the third city in the Roman Empire and a key outpost for spreading the Christian faith. You could argue that maybe he only spent 1 year there as opposed to 18 months or 2 years because he had two of them then. He was joined with Barnabas. Barnabas could take a large part of the workload, and so a year would do it in Antioch before Paul then went out and reached other fields. So what then did Paul and Barnabas teach in Antioch? And the answer to that would be to consider Paul's sermons in the book of Acts. We have several of them summarized. And Paul's inspired epistles later in the New Testament. Those two things, I think we would all agree, would be a pretty good guide. So they taught the Old Testament, did Paul and Barnabas. They taught Bible history. If Paul's sermon in Antioch in Pisidia in Acts 13 is anything to go by. These are Gentiles. These are pagans. They need to know the basic storyline of the scriptures to grasp the Christian religion. And in teaching the Old Testament, Paul and Barnabas taught the Old Testament with a distinctive Christian interpretation, not as foisting this upon it, but as bringing out what's genuinely and truly there. Look with me at Acts 16, verses 2 and 3. Here Paul is engaging in missionary work in the synagogue at Thessalonica. Acts 17, verse 2. And Paul, as his manner was, this was his custom, went in unto them in the synagogue, and 3 Sabbath days, Saturdays, when they would be there, reasoned with them out of the scriptures. Here's the Old Testament. Now, what does this say? What does this mean? Of whom is the prophet writing? Verse 3. Opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead. That's what he proved from the Old Testament. 1, the Messiah's coming. 2, that he must suffer. And 3, that after that he must be raised from the dead. And then, that this Jesus, whom I preach unto you, the one who died a few years ago at the hands of Pontius Pilate being crucified, this Jesus is the same one that Moses wrote about in Isaiah and the Psalmists. And so you can understand that Paul and Barnabas were in this church in Antioch teaching. They explained the proper Christian interpretation all the way from Genesis to Malachi. And flowing from an understanding of the basic storyline of Bible history, understood with a thoroughly Christian interpretation, the Apostle Paul taught the key elements of Christian theology. He did this, for instance, in his speech or sermon on Mars Hill in Athens in Acts 17. He told them there's a God who made the universe. This God made all mankind out of one blood. And in this God we live and move and have our being. And since God has made us, we often think that the Godhead can be made out of silver and gold. And that God sent his Son, Jesus Christ, who was raised from the dead, who's coming again to judge the world. Key theological points of the Christian message. And if you turn to Paul's epistles, you will see there a key word, a mystery. The mystery. That which was hidden in God from all eternity, and man could never have searched out or guessed that God would send his own Son to become incarnate, and that he would die on the cross for guilty sinners. And that in this way God would gather a Catholic Church out of Jews and Gentiles, and that one day, when everything will be summed up in Christ in the world to come, we will possess all things in him in the new heavens and the new earth. This is the mystery. This is the key to the universe. That which was hidden and which the great men of the world did not know, would never have found out, and now deny. The mystery. And if you want to ask further, what sort of things would the apostle have taught, along with Barnabas, in Antioch, you could do worse than summarize Paul's most systematic epistle, Romans. He taught about sin and total depravity, chapters 1 through 3 and chapter 5. He taught them about justification and sanctification, so they were righteous by the holy life and sacrificial death of Jesus Christ alone, and that God sanctifies us by the inner working of the Holy Ghost through faith. And he taught them about God's eternal double predestination, including God's purpose with Israel, Romans 9 through 11. And throw into the mix some other key elements from the book of Romans, the truth about preaching, spiritual gifts, the church as Christ's body, proper submission to the state, Romans 13, Christian liberty, and missionary methods. Those sorts of things. He's teaching these people for a year, systematically, deeply, profoundly. And of course, Paul and Barnabas would have taught these converted Gentiles of the meaning and glory of the Psalms, far and away the longest book of the Old Testament, as the inspired songbook of the Christian church, as per Acts 16, 1 Corinthians 14, Ephesians 5, and Colossians 3. And there's another clue given in our text as to the teaching of Paul and Barnabas at Antioch. Comes in the last sentence of verse 26. And the disciples were called Christians first in Antioch. The ascription of the name Christian to these disciples flows from the fact that Paul and Barnabas taught Jesus Christ and his cross as the fulfillment of the Old Testament. That they taught Christ and his cross as the heart of the Psalms. That they taught Christ and his cross as the revelation of the mystery. And they taught Christ as the only mediator through whom God comes to us, through whom we go to God. And so Jesus Christ is all, so that God may be all in all. For of him, and through him, and to him are all things, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Romans 11, verse 36 on the plaque in the foyer or narthex of this building.